Ta-da! If that really worked. Ta-da! If it didn't work. I am Hari Sreenivasan. This is the Doubleheader, where we talk about the sport of politics and the politics of sport with none other than Mark Shields and David Brooks. But this edition is super special. So super that it's supercalifragilisticexpialidocious because it's live and we are taking your questions. So if you're on Twitter, for example, you can do hashtag Doubleheader Live, and I've got this little tablet and I'll try to find your question. And we've been taking questions, frankly, for the last 3 weeks. So there's a fair number of people who have heard of you, and then they've told their friends, and then those friends have pretended to be new viewers and written in.
Good.
Right? Okay. So we're going to go, we're going to start with something from the live batch now, if we can. Let me work this app business here. Okay. First up, which one of you is taller? Mark Shields or David Brooks? They always see you sitting down.
I am.
Go ahead, stand up. Just to answer the question. It's going to be that much easier. Really?
Because you know what the number one comment I get when people see me?
Which is?
You're taller than I thought.
You're a lot shorter than I thought you were. I actually sit tall. I think Mark sits tall too.
I sit tall in the saddle.
Do you?
Yeah.
Okay.
So Mark is
tall. I'm 4'11".
Okay. No. So we will continue with these live questions. We're going to go to what we usually do every week, which is talk about the sport of politics and the politics of sport. All right. In the sport of politics section, this is kind of a truncated version of what we do. This week we saw the Farm Bill collapse, burn in shambles, however you want to put it. I mean, this was supposed to be a bipartisan bill, but neither side could really get their act together. What's going to happen with it? Start with you.
I think the easy thing to do, the logical thing would be that, well, it's passed the Senate, so let's take the Senate bill up. But there's not a chance in the world of that happening in the House, because the House has proved itself to be a maverick institution, ungovernable by its leadership. In this case, Speaker Boehner had announced his own support, which a speaker rarely does, said he would vote for the farm bill, and then couldn't even muster the support, lost 62 of his own caucus. I mean, a speaker doesn't lose 62 votes on a procedural matter, that is, making the bill on the floor. And he had been, I think it's fair to say, sabotaged by his House Majority Leader, Eric Cantor, who had supported an amendment which they'd warned was going to cost them votes, and it did. It was a punitive amendment on for food stamp recipients that seven-year-olds had to work 80 hours a week. No, that, but I mean, it had that
in
kind of
feel.
In a shoe factory. In
a shoe
factory in Thailand.
Right.
But so, I mean, you know, I at this point, I don't know what's going to happen other than the fact that it's a terrible blow to the Speaker's leadership.
Okay.
Yes, it is.
Really?
I have some. It's a blow to his leadership, but he's had some blows before. Remember Plan B in the middle of the budget process?
Yeah.
He's had some blows before. I sort of have some sympathy with the rebels on this one. Not on the food stamps. I was all piped, you know, the number of people taking food stamps or receiving food stamps has just grown quickly. And so I was all hyped up to do a column saying it's the program's growing out of control until I did a little research into who's actually getting them, and basically the people who are getting them deserve to be getting them.
Mm-hmm.
On the other hand, there's some other parts of the program which I think are legitimately objecting to, the commodity sports, crop insurance, things like that, which are a little corporate welfare, really.
Okay.
David's absolutely right. I mean, it is somehow corrosive to your character if you're 11 years old and hungry and getting food stamps, but if you're corporation getting subsidies, it in no way threatens your character.
Okay.
I mean, it's a fascinating ethical standard.
All right. The politics of sport this week, obviously there were a couple of basketball games. Yeah. I don't know, a few people watched.
I did.
Did you?
Yes, I did.
And there was also, there's some hockey games going on too. So basketball-wise, the question that came in, G Wonk asks, greatest ever LeBron or Jordan? You guys have semi-answered this before, but.
I think the test is, does that player make those around him better?
Mm-hmm.
And it's hard to argue that, with the exception of Scottie Pippen, that Michael Jordan played with, you know, NBA All-Stars.
Right.
They've assembled an All-Star team in Miami. I think LeBron James is an enormous talent. I think he willed victory in at least two of those games. But I was rooting for San Antonio. I really was, and therefore I didn't sleep all last night.
Okay.
Yeah.
And
I read a tweet from Nate Silver who said that Jordan won his first title at 27 and then his second at 28, which is exactly what LeBron has just done.
Another guy just asked FL3UV3. I'm sorry, it's a guy or a girl, but it says, will LeBron come back to Cleveland now that he has his two rings?
He's going straight to Akron. He's going to start a program.
He's
in
a guy
Akron.
From Akron.
So the moral question is, should you root for your generation's, your era's greatest sports figure?
Right.
Just as so you can say, well, my era's, my LeBron, he was great. So should you root for Tiger? Should you root for LeBron?
Well, that's interesting.
Bill Russell?
Bill Russell. Well, so you should, if you're like 25 years old, you should want your LeBron to be
the greatest. Greatest.
I root for Ty Cobb and James Naismith, the founder of basketball, yes. Ty Cobb and baseball. But
Ethel read the unready and jousting.
I love Ethel read the unready.
Okay. We're going to get to some of the pre-submitted questions that we've had for the past couple of weeks building up on our site, on our Facebook page, et cetera, et cetera. And we are going to give some prizes away. We don't exactly know which person is going to get what prize, but if we selected your name, then you have to somehow communicate with us your address, and we'll mail you some stuff. All right.
Be careful about sending the address.
that's right, not this address, but your address. Fernando Itriburu asked, I'm sorry if I butchered your name, my name's Sreenivasan. So, what are your permanent political and ideological differences?
Have you guys
bumped into something over and over again where you say, obviously, my dear colleague Mark Shields does not agree with me on this, or vice versa?
I don't know. I mean, David is so flexible when he's grown. As he's come to agree with me more often, I like to say he's grown.
he's come around to your way.
That's right. No. I don't know. I'm more optimistic and confident about the role of government.
Okay.
He's
not.
I think David is more skeptical, and I think legitimately so.
And American Power, I think I'm a little more aggressive.
David is a little more aggressive, although he seemed to be less enthusiastic about the war in Iraq after it started than he was before it started.
All right.
Is that fair to say?
Yeah. That is fair to say. Yeah.
All right, Jim Stoll asked.
It's unfair to say it, but it's fair to say.
If you were more aggressive after the war on poverty failed, you were more supporting than
I was more,
before.
The war on poverty was, and the rich won it. I mean, that was it. Unfortunately.
Okay, Jim Stahl from the website asks, do you envision another political party in the U.S. that would be more middle ground than on the far end, like the Tea Party?
No.
No.
I think there are structural barriers. I think there are actually a lot of centrists in the country, but they don't have much power, partly for intellectual reasons. People in the center complain a lot. They actually haven't come up with think tanks, fundraising, and an agenda.
Yep.
So I am sort of more in the center than not, but I think centrists have a lot to answer for the void in the center, not just the polarization on the ends.
Okay. Richard 5177 says, do you agree that corporate money is having an increasingly detrimental effect on U.S. politics, and what can we done about it? I mean, you guys talked about this around Citizens United a while back, too, but...
Yes, I think our politics is in jeopardy of becoming a plutocracy. I don't think there's any question that we saw in 2012. Historically, candidates to do well for president, whether rightly or wrongly, had to do well in Iowa and New Hampshire. We had two candidates who finished fourth in Iowa and New Hampshire, weak fourth in both the states, in the case of Newt Gingrich. Because he had one person, Sheldon Adelson, who had come up with $100 million, it sustained his candidacy. And so now, instead of going out and meeting the city council members in Dubuque or the school member board in Laconia, New Hampshire, as candidates historically have done, all you have to do is woo and find yourself some deep-pocketed Daddy Warbucks who are willing to underwrite your campaign. And I just think that's dangerous.
And I would say that politicians, even though they all get reelected these days, they're deeply, deeply insecure, and they think the way to assuage their insecurity is with money.
And to scare off opponents.
So they spend a lot of time raising money, and as a result, they become, frankly, more unidimensional human beings.
Ooh. Them is fighting words. You unidimensional human being politicians.
It's actually, if you try to reach around them, there's nothing back
there.
There's
nothing there,
right? A couple who are Presbyterians. So.
A few different type of viewers have asked this question. Jim D'Amato of the website says, how severe is the political and economic polarization in our country? Is this something from which we can, as a nation, can recover? Have You guys have been around and seen this in different cycles. Is it bad? Is it the worst?
It's not the worst. The Civil War was pretty bad.
That was pretty bad.
My hero Alexander Hamilton was shot by the vice president, Aaron Burr. That was a reasonably polarizing act.
It was unfriendly.
It was impolite.
It wasn't civil.
He would not get the Allegheny College Civility Award. That's Aaron Burr not going to get there.
No.
There tends to be cycles. The weird thing is we've been in our cycle for a long, long time, and it continues to deteriorate.
Okay.
I think it's really bad, and I think it's poisonous in the sense of, and I think it's something to the NewsHour's credit that nobody on the show ever indulges in to the best of my, they certainly do if they don't get invited back, if they do. And that is, you have to acknowledge the legitimacy of the other person's point of view. And I just think we've reached a point now in American politics where denying the legitimacy or the patriotism or the intelligence of your adversary is somehow acceptable tactics. And boy, that this, once I say, instead of you're being mistaken, or I don't think you've got all the information, saying you're evil or you're stupid, then that foregoes or forecloses the chances of working together in a future coalition. And so it becomes a self-fulfilling polarization.
Okay. Robert Nagel asks, based on your talks with policymakers and politicians, do you get the sense that climate change will be changing from a back burner item to a front burner item anytime soon?
Nope. No, I don't think so. President Obama is on the verge of announcing a new initiative, which will probably be about coal-fired power plants. Nonetheless, I think the political landscape is what it has been, which is that people sort of like the idea and theory of doing something on global change, but as soon as there's some economic cost, they walk away from it.
Sadly, I think David is right. And I think one of the other problems is it's just too big an idea. I mean, it is, you know, I mean, it isn't like we can take a step, we can build a bridge, we can, I mean, it's just such an enormous idea. I mean, it's almost going to take something like the polar cap disappearing to get people. Now, you know, it should, I mean, we see the oceans rising. We see, you know, beachfront property now in Kansas, Will.
Are you a realtor?
I was hoping.
Okay, we're going to shift into the lightning round. Now Ed Woody from Facebook asks,
I'd like to take Shakespearean actors.
Shakespearean actors for 200 is not the lightning round. Ed Woody from Facebook asks, favorite politician? Do you have one?
Favorite politician? Mike Mansfield, who was the Senate Majority Leader, is remains one of my favorites. Robert Kennedy, for whom I worked, remains one.
Those are two legit.
Let me think. I grew up on Hubert Humphrey, who I still have a soft spot for.
Mm-hmm.
But I would say of the living, I'm going to list some the practicing right now. Who I'm just going to stick with a couple senators: Amy Klobuchar, Minnesota; Ron Wyden; Lindsey Graham.
Wow.
John Barrasso. They're thoughtful, good senators.
All right. Have either?
That's what's known as a beet sweetener.
Because they're all four of them are watching right now.
Everyone has that. That's right. I hear what David said. David would like to come back and spend
Barack
hours.
Obama, in that case.
Yes or no, have either of you ever changed the other's mind on a political issue?
Yes.
Look at that. That was big of him. Yeah. You better say yes. Yeah. Really?
Yeah. I have changed. I've changed David several times.
How about you?
We have conversations, so minds change existentially over the course of conversations with events.
Okay.
But the road to Damascus, that would be...
Right. Best ballpark to watch a baseball game?
I'm going to be a total heretic here. I mean, I should say Fenway and Camden Yards. And I think the Colorado Rockies Stadium is the best stadium I've ever been in. Why? Because when you go to the stands to get a Coke or a hot dog or a beer, the sight lines are such that you can watch the game while you're there. And that, to me, is as viewer-friendly and fan-friendly a place as you're going to find.
Yeah, I like that stadium. The people are too nice, though. I would like a little tension in the tension in the crowd.
The nicer
that, and the Arizona Diamondbacks have a fantastic stadium. Again, a little
it's already
nice.
High altitude, so the nosebleeds not incremental.
I'm
right.
Going with the Pittsburgh Pirates Stadium,
really?
Which is a beautiful
stadium?
Downtown
stadium. I've never been there, and I've heard nothing but good things about it.
Favorite book about politics, if you have one?
I'm going with, I was raised and got into politics reading Robert Penn Warren's novel, All the King's Men.
Great.
Well, that was a good book.
Broderick Crawford in the movie is a wonderful, wonderful movie, too. Yeah. It's one of the few great movies made from a great book. I'd say The Last Hurrah by Edwin O'Connor.
It's a
great, great study of American urban politics.
Favorite state to visit during primary / general election?
Iowa. Love Iowa. Iowa looks just like Iowa should look.
Mark?
I love Iowa. I love New Hampshire. If you really want to find out what America's going to do, you got to go to Ohio.
Ohio, okay. And then Stanley Cup Finals pick.
Yeah, I'm going with the Blackhawks.
I
watched a lot of the games. We've had, I think, 3 overtime games so far.
Yeah. Yep.
It's been terrific. But I'm going with Chicago, which is going to disturb everybody else in the Midwest because they hate the Blackhawks.
Okay.
I'm going with the Bruins. I think this is their time. I think they're a team of destiny, and I'll even throw in there's no tomorrow.
You know, Boston is a spoiled sports town these days. Every team
is
good.
Not when it comes to tight ends.
that's true.
All right, so in our hats, we all have little questions here, and we will actually be giving away these hats. We're saying it on the record so that Mark Shields cannot keep his hat. The reason that they are these hats is because he just dropped all your questions. Oh, what
hey,
a
you
cool
can take some of mine.
Could one of my crack staff pick that
yes.
up?
Yes. All right, so let's start
okay,
with
I'm
you.
Okay, I'm picking.
Pick up one question
of
out of the hat.
Many different questions. There are only 2 questions.
Are there?
Here. Okay. Matthew Brooks, website. What's your favorite song?
Wow.
Okay, song. Right now we're going with Racing in the Street by Bruce Springsteen.
Okay.
Really?
Yeah, it rotates, but that's it
right, now. Racing in the Street.
No
by Bruce
kidding.
Springsteen.
The modern version.
How about you? Get
my
a
favorite
question.
Song?
No.
Oh.
Just your question.
Yeah, but
we can
your favorite song.
Song.
This
my
is something
song,
I've never
favorite.
Been asked in public before.
I never have either, and it's a great question. And I've got 3 favorite songs.
Wait, is Matthew Brooks related?
Did Avril Lavigne do all of them?
This one is from David Brooks. No, it's Selena Redden from Facebook.
Okay.
Favorite hobbies?
Yeah, do you have a hobby?
Do I have a hobby?
Besides this?
I mean, other than woodworking and putting ships in bottles. My favorite hobby is on Friday afternoons with Hari, who, by the way, let it be noted.
News Hour weekend,
the star thereof,
okay.
The anchor, Hari.
Yeah.
But my favorite songs? I Left My Heart in San Francisco, Tony Bennett. It's a great song. It really is.
Okay. And the Clash had a better version.
Yeah, no.
That you know
different
that.
Different generations.
Yes. Okay.
And Louis Armstrong.
Louis Armstrong, the Clash version of that song. All right, so my question was from at Visual Justice. Do Mark and David share any pre- or post-show rituals together, dinner and a movie, an elite DC haunt, bowling, M&Ms?
We go roller skating a lot.
Roller skating?
Yeah.
The four-wheeled shoe kind?
It used to be roller derby, but Mark can't. His knees can't take it.
No, can't. And the outfit was silly. Is there there is no
really
a ritual. I mean,
there is something with the M&Ms.
We chat.
We both.
Yeah, we both do like M&Ms.
Peanut M&Ms.
Peanut M&Ms specifically.
And if there's an advertising contract in it for us, that would be welcome.
Right.
Yeah.
Right, sponsored by.
Yeah, we're available basically for anything.
Okay.
I mean, we're total hookers when it comes to candy.
Corporate sponsorship.
I can't say hooker. That's
why didn't I think?
Call human resources.
Call human resources. Yes. Call person. Call person is better than.
Yeah.
Right. All right. On that, tawdry. See now, see how long it took to get around to
I
that.
I know it.
All right.
He's quick. I'll tell you. He just got married, and he's got a new show. And he's Harry.
Thanks. Thanks so much. All right. Thank you for watching, bearing with us, and all your questions. This has been a live special edition of the Doubleheader with Mark Shields, David Brooks. I'm Harry Sreenivasan. Good night. So
we give this to the
we're gonna sign these.
This goes okay.